welcome. Let's all stand together. Why don't you turn and smile at somebody? Greet them. Say hello, how are you? Amen. I wonder if we could just begin to lift up our hands to Jesus. Lord, we lift you up in this place. Have your way in this house, Jesus. Pray that you'd move in this place.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind away? It was my shame till I met you. I was breathing but not chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan.
I'm living in the light now.
we might become his righteousness. His body was broken for our transgressions, but I'm so glad that's not where the story.
You up, Jesus. Hallelujah. You're a mighty God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we lift you up in this place.
Once more, worthy, worthy, worthy.
up, Jesus. Come on, if he's worthy, would you just use your words to lift him up? You're worthy of all the praise that I can give, Jesus. Lord, we lift you up in this place. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for bringing me here today, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen, amen. Can we just put our hands together and thank him? Jesus, you're so good. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen, amen. We're going to go to him right now in prayer. Please remember my grandma, Rosemary Jones. She is currently in at a GI doctor in Carmel. They're going to keep her for a couple of days, and hopefully she can get released this week. But keep her in your prayers. Sister Kathy Smith needs our prayers today, and continue to remember Sarah Koppel as she recovers. Let's just pray that God just has his way in our hearts today. Let's make our hearts available for him to move. Amen. Jesus, we thank you for this chance you've given us to come into your presence. We thank you for your spirit that we felt here today, God, that you would just continue to move. We ask that you would just move in our hearts, move in our lives, God, that you would touch someone here today, God, that you would change someone's life in this moment today, that you would touch someone's heart today, God, that you would just do a supernatural work, God, that you would break chains, that you would just open doors, that you would do a miraculous work in somebody's life here this morning. Lord, we're asking that you would touch the needs that we've mentioned this morning, that you would touch Rosemary Jones, that you touch her body, that you would touch Sister Kathy Smith and her body, and that you would continue to touch Sarah Koppel. We know that you're able, God. We know that you can do all things, and we're just trusting these things to your care, and every other need that's represented by someone here today, God, we're trusting it to you today. We're trusting that you're going to do a great and mighty work in our lives and in the lives of everyone here today, God, and we're going to make your name great when we leave from this place. We'll give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. We're going to ask our ushers to come at this time. Amen. Let's pay attention to the announcements as we give today. Part of the service. We're going to dismiss the kids here in just a moment, but I heard there's going to be some very special guests joining the kids today. So let's go ahead and let the kids at all ages 2 to 11, we're going to let you go out this way. I know they're going to have a great time this morning. I heard there's going to be some puppets back there today. So, I know. We'll just all go back here. No, we're going to hear from the word of the Lord this morning. Why don't we welcome Pastor as he comes to bring the word of the Lord this morning.
Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. It's good to be here. Appreciate the prayers for my wife. And trust the Lord's going to do something very special here today. A couple housekeeping things real quick. You'll see back at guest services these envelopes. This is for Christmas for Christ offering. It has a denomination on the front that you can ignore. You can give whatever gift that you feel like you would want to give, and be mindful of that. We'll be receiving a Christmas for Christ offering in December, giving you a little bit of time to start preparing for that. It's North American missions is what it goes to support, and it predominantly is to plant churches is there's so many things that it does, but one of the biggest things that it does is it goes to plant churches in communities that do not have a church, home missions work. And it's near and dear to our hearts as we are a home mission church. And so we want to continue to support this just like we do every year. And we're going to do that. So if you want to pick one of these up at guest services, please do that and start thinking and praying about what it is you want to give. Also, you noticed on the overhead, no doubt, you probably saw that we have a church banquet coming up. That's December 4th. We'll have a sign-up sheet ready for you on Wednesday so you can get signed up and some of the particulars. But we had a great time last year. It's down here at just around the corner, basically, at Crystal Coop. And we had a lot of fun and good food and just hanging out together and spending a little bit of time on a Wednesday night. It's going to be great. You're going to love it. We'll get that sign-up sheet for you, and so we can get an idea of how many people we've got coming. And then finally, the Life Group DVDs are at guest services. The icebreaker and questions and everything, it's all on the DVD now. Everything is contained in one place. So Life Group leaders, if you're having your group tonight, by all means, do that. You can pick up your DVD in the back. Our actual Life Groups are scheduled for the 24th this month, but we did make it available to you a little bit early as a one-time offer. This offer expires after today. Just teasing, just kidding. Well, it's so good to be here today. I wonder if just for the moment right now, if we could just kind of refocus our minds and our hearts and our spirits. We're having a beautiful service already today. Feel the presence of the Lord here, can't you? Amen. Amen. Great is your mercy toward me. Your loving kindness toward me. Your tender mercy I see day after day. Hallelujah. Always providing for me. Great is your mercy toward me. Great is your grace. Great is your mercy toward me. Your loving kindness towards me. Your tender mercy I see day after day. Forever faithful toward me. You're always providing for me. Great is your mercy toward me. Great is your grace. Stand with me, let's sing. Great is your mercy for me. Your loving kindness for me. Your tender mercies I see day after day. Forever faithful. Forever faithful towards me. You're always providing. Great is your mercy toward me. your grace. 2 Chronicles 7, verse 14. You know it. You know it well. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Speak to you on this subject this morning. If I will, he will. Turn to your neighbor before you're seated and say, I will. You may be seated. It's not a negotiation that's happening here. This is a statement of fact to all of Israel. Now let's get some context to this, all right? David wanted to do it, but the Lord would not allow him to, because he was a man of war and he spilled a lot of blood. He killed a lot of giants. He killed a lot of Philistines, and he wasn't able. And David had some things in his life that prohibited him from doing what he really wanted to do, and that was build the Lord's house. But the Lord told David, he said, it's not for you to build. It's going to be your son that builds it. Solomon is going to build me a house. And Solomon did that, and that's where we find ourselves here in 2 Chronicles 7, is that Solomon has finished the building of the temple. And so we have it, and the Bible says they celebrated, they dedicated, they worshiped, and they couldn't even, the priests couldn't even enter the house of the Lord because the presence of God had filled it so powerfully, so mightily, so greatly that they were not even able to enter in. And that's where we are. That's where we find ourselves. And the Lord, it says to Solomon here in chapter 7, he says, listen, here's the thing. I approve. I may be paraphrasing this part. I'm not reading it directly from the Bible, so go with me on this. But that's what the Lord is telling Solomon. He says, I approve of what you've done. I sanction it. I bless it. This is my house. Now and forever, this is my house. I'm going to abide here with my people. It won't be anywhere else. It will never change. It will, from here until the end of time and time beyond time, this is my abode. I'll abide here with my people in the house that you built. And of course, we know, you know, we're not talking about the structural building here. We're talking about even after Christ has died and rose again, this, know you not that your body is the temple of, and then what the Lord is saying, I'm going to abide here with you. Are you with me so far? Say, yeah. But you're going to mess up. It's what he's telling Solomon. You're going to mess up. The people are going to make mistakes. It's going to happen. I'm going to live here with you. This is my abode. This is my house. But you're going to mess it up. It won't stop me from being your God. It won't stop me from this place being my house. That's never going to change. This is not a negotiation. I'm telling you what is. I'm telling you what's going to be. I'm telling you this will never change. But I'm also telling you, you're going to make mistakes. You're going to mess up. Any gamers in the house? You know, if you're a gamer, what it means to get a cheat code. You like cheat codes. Well, I don't like cheat codes, you dirty cheaters. No, I'm just kidding. Cheat codes help you win the game, I suppose. I'm not much of a gamer. I get sick, you know, playing Mario Wii or whatever it is. I, I struggle playing the cart game. You know, it's not my cup of tea. If it's your cup of tea, great. I don't drink tea. I drink coffee. Like real men. I'm just teasing. I'm kidding. I'm not making fun of gamers. But the Lord's giving Israel a cheat code here. He's saying, you're going to mess up. That's what he's telling them. You need to know that I know that you're going to make mistakes. And I'm going to tell you what you need to do when that happens, because it's going to happen. Okay, so this is what he says. If my people, how do we know we're his people? How do we know that? I'll show you. Brother Steve's going to help us out. He's going to put our verse back up, and we're going to talk about it today. Is this all right? Somebody say, I will. I will. Right. So if my people, and we know we are his people for one reason and one reason only, we're called by his name. Come on, somebody. I'm not talking about any people. I'm talking about his people. I'm not talking about any name. I'm talking about the name that's above every name. The name whereby we must be saved, the Bible says. The name that Peter said, repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. You shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. I'm talking about his name, the nailed hand that saves, the great I am, his name. And we are the people of his name. That's how we know we're his people. We have his name on us. If we don't have his name on us, then we could be anybody's people. Anybody ever write a check? You ever try writing a check and signing a name on the check that wasn't attached to the account holder? Young people don't even know what checks are. Like, check, does he mean Apple Pay? He doesn't mean Apple Pay. What's a check? You mean like a check mark? You try signing a check for an account that doesn't belong to you, you're not able to draw on the funds that are within that account. You need to be attached to the account somehow. We're attached to the account by way of having his name on us. What I'm saying on Baptism Sunday is we are buried with him in baptism. We get his name placed on us, and we become part of his people because we have his name on us. And so what he's saying is, you're going to mess up. You're going to make mistakes. But if my people, which are called by my name, first and foremost, we are the people that are called by his name. That's an important distinction. There's a lot of people out here that are calling, and the Lord addresses it. He said, many are going to say, Lord, Lord, and I'm going to say, I never knew you. Why? Because his name's not on them. There's a lot of people doing a lot of good things for Jesus. There's a lot of people doing a lot of great things for God. But if you don't have his name on you, you need to be born again of the water and of the Spirit. And when they bury you in the water, they need to be saying, in Jesus' name. That's because we're the people of his name. He's going to do it for his name's sake. Who sent me? I am. Tell them I am that I am. That is my name. I am. The I am sent me. Jesus is the name, and we are the people of that name. So what happens is when you mess up, people of the name, you have an opportunity to get things right again. Let me show you how we do that. First and foremost, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves. That is a complete thought right there. We need to be able to, you know, prostrate ourselves before the Lord, face down, metaphorically speaking, before the Lord. We need to bring our spirits under subjection. God's going to do a lot of great things in your life, and it won't be because you're talented. It won't. He's not going to give you podiums to speak from because you're a great speaker. He's not going to give you microphones to sing into because you're a great singer. He's going to do great things in your life, and he's going to give you great blessings because you're submitted to his will, you're submitted to his purpose, you're submitted to his person. I'm talking about obedience here. It's better than all the sacrifices you can make. And we can make a lot of sacrifices. But what he's looking for is our submission. And James talks about it. He says, submit yourselves, therefore, unto God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. If you want to resist the devil and have him flee from you, let's get ourselves aligned with his word. And what does God's word say? His word says, my people, which are called by my name, need to humble themselves. Too many people are still pounding their chest. If we humble ourselves, we begin to see ourselves the way that we should see ourselves, right? This is important. It's important because you can't see him in his proper, this is about positioning. You can't see God in his proper position if you don't have yourself in your proper position, okay? Does that make sense? This is not a thing where he serves my needs. Michael, I serve his needs. I come to the house of the Lord to serve the Lord with gladness. Does that make sense? But we get so caught up in what we need that we sometimes forget what he needs. And when we're focused on what I need, we get ourselves, everything comes from that viewpoint. If we position ourselves appropriately, which is face down before a sovereign deity, humble ourselves, position myself, then I get to see him properly. Does that make sense? I see him properly when I've got myself positioned correctly. I need to be positioned right. This is about locale. This is about logistics. Think about it this way. As individuals, we are all equal. We're all human beings. We're all sons and daughters of the King. We're all equal in that. But in some capacities, we're not all equal, are we? Right. Okay, Andrew, let's take you and I and Derek here, the three of us. So I'm a VP of Indiana, and Andrew runs the biggest region in Indiana. Andrew answers to me from a title standpoint. Does that make sense? And Derek is a general manager of a single location. He answers to Andrew from a title standpoint. Derek and I are equal as men, as servants of the Lord, of the Most High God. We are equal, okay? But we are not equal in authority in this venue over here. When it comes to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, can I tell you something, church? None of us are equal to him. Even if I'm in relationship with him, we better understand what that relationship is. Yes, he's a friend that sticks closer than a brother. He's a father, he's a mother, he's a brother, he's a sister. He's a best friend, he's all of those things. But before he's all of those things, he is the Lord God Almighty, the first and the last, the Alpha and the Omega. He is a sovereign deity. And just so there's no confusion, in this, I was not equating myself to a sovereign deity in our work world. I'm saying that there are structures and hierarchies, even in the church, right? You have a pastor. You are to submit yourself to your pastor. I submit myself to my pastor. He will always be my pastor. You know why? Because I will always need a pastor. Everybody needs a, he has a pastor. Everybody is under submission to someone. We need to, the Bible says, submit yourselves one to another. We should be submitted. And so when the Lord's speaking to Solomon, he says, I love what you're doing here, that my presence has filled the place. And I'm going to be here forever, Solomon. Thank you. I love it. I love it. But you need to know, I see it. I see what you can't see. My ways are above your ways. My thought, and you're gonna mess up. And when you do, I'm gonna give you a recipe for it, okay? Here comes the cheat code. First and foremost, get me positioned where I should be. Humble yourself before me. Get me where I should be, and because you're of my name. And then the next thing you need to do is start praying about it. You need to pray about it. You need to bring it to me. You need to pray about it. You need to talk about it. And Jesus said it this way. He said, ask, you shall receive. Seek, and you shall knock, and it will be open. You need to start the asking process. I know you. When you mess up, you're going to have to get me positioned right and then bring me the problem, okay? Because I notice here that he's not chasing me. Is this all right? You notice that? He's not chasing me. He said, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray. Everything's on me right now. Everything's on me right now. I've got to humble myself, and I've got to bring him the thing, whatever the thing is. We all have a thing, right? Everybody's got some thing in their life that, you know, maybe it's like Paul, it's that thorn in the flesh, you know. And for him, a lot of people believe it was his eyesight never was fully what it used to be before, you know, he was struck down on the road to Damascus. There's no evidence of that, but that's just a sort of a common thought process. It doesn't matter what it was. What matters is the Lord said, no, my grace is sufficient. We all have something. In this case, right in the midst of this celebration of dedicating the temple, the Lord's saying, I need you to understand that I've got you. I've got you, but there's things that you're going to need to do for me to have you. Church, there's things that we need to do for God to have our backs, for God to work in our lives. We have to allow him to work in our lives. This doesn't work unless we initiate, right? We have to allow God to work in our lives by firstly submitting ourselves. Let's get rid of ego. Let's get rid of the me monster, right? Let's get rid of it and start focusing on the Lord. And then we begin to pray about it. And we earnestly ask God for, you know, I need forgiveness here. But you see, he didn't stop there with prayer, and it's not the same thing. And how do we know that? Because we like grammar a lot. I love grammar when I read the Bible. I love it. Watch this. Shall humble themselves, comma. So humble themselves is one, right? And pray, comma. Whoop, 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 whoop. Not pray and seek as one thought. Pray as its own thing. Seek as its own thing. Can I tell you something? You can pray about stuff and not seek the Lord. You can pray about the stuff you want, the stuff you need, the stuff you desire, the things that you want to happen in your life. You can pray about that and never seek his person, never seek his purpose, never seek his will. We can pray about what we want and not seek him. But what he's saying is, if you will humble yourself, right? You get me positioned correctly and you start praying about it, but then you go past prayer into earnestly, diligently seeking me. If you will seek my face, there's going to be some special things start to happen here, but you got to seek me. If you do seek me, what will happen? You'll find me. A whole lot of people not finding the Lord. Why? They're simply not looking for him. They're not seeking after the Lord. You're not going to find, you know, if you're sitting here today on these lovely, comfortable, padded seats, and you're waiting for the Lord God Almighty to come down. Well, if the Lord wants me to come to the altar, he'll come down and get me. No, he won't. He wants you to come to the altar. So you got to get up and come. He's not coming to you. You got to come to him. He's not seeking. He sought you. He found you. He saved you. You got to seek him. Watch this. And turn from their wicked ways. You've got to turn. What does that tell us? Here's what it tells us. We're involved in wicked ways. This is what the Lord's telling them. You understand what I'm saying, church? You were with me. We dedicated the temple together. I filled the house. My presence was with you. You were seeking hard after me. You were praying. You were worshiping. It was all good. I'm telling you what's going to happen in the future, though. At some point, you left this, and you sought after this. It's funny, Noah, that I went to the drums. the wicked. The holy instrument is the piano. Unless you're Pentecostal, and then it's the B3. Let's not play. Let's not play. It's the B3. No, what happened was we were here with God, and we left that. And so now what he's instructing us is this. He's saying, if you'll humble yourself, if you'll pray, if you'll seek, but you all of that's not going to work if you don't turn. You've got to turn from it. You've got to get away from it. Now watch. If you turn from it, you abandon it, you get back here to zero, right? You're praying about it. You're seeking my face. You've humbled yourself. You've done your part. Everybody say, I will. I will. If I will, then what? He will. I'm telling you, this is a covenant made with Solomon. Do you understand what I'm saying? If you do it, then I'll do it. If you keep your part of it, then I'll keep my part of it. But you got to keep your part of it. And if you do keep your part of it, the first thing that's going to happen is, I will hear. Isn't it nice to be heard once in a while? You ever been involved in a relationship and you feel like the person you're involved with doesn't hear anything you're saying? None of the wives said amen. They're not telling the truth. Thank you, Chris. I will hear you, is what the Lord said. If you will, then I will. I'm going to hear you, and it's nice to be heard of the Lord, isn't it? Can I get an amen? Amen. It's nice when the Lord hears me. He hears my cry. He hears my petition. Late on in the midnight hour, if I call on his name, he's that present help. David said, hear my cry, O Lord, and attend unto my prayer. From the ends of the earth have I cried unto thee. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Amen. Create in me a clean heart. God's hearing him. Renew a right spirit within me. God's hearing that. Because when I call on him and I turn from, and that's what David did. He turned from his sin. He said, I alone did this. I sinned. It wasn't anybody else. I didn't get tricked into it. I didn't actually fall into it. I did what I wanted to do, Lord, and I made a mistake. And I need you to create in me a clean heart. I need you to renew a right spirit within me, the Bible says in Psalm 50 and 51. What he's saying is, lead me by those still waters one more time. Lead me in that path of righteousness just one more time. One more time, Lord. One more time. Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. It's critically important. God hears me when I call on him. Amen? When I call on the name of the Lord, the Bible says, I will hear, but watch this. Watch this. I will hear from heaven. And we need him to hear from heaven, not hell. Because hell's got some nasty things to say about us. I didn't say they were lying. I didn't say they were wrong. Does the devil have the goods on us or not? Just me then? Just me that has a past? Just me that has skeletons in a closet? Anybody ever have a skeleton in the closet? Maybe a monster living under the bed? Come on. Come on, somebody. There's some monsters that need to be slain. There's some closets that need to be cleaned out of some of those old skeletons. But he's not hearing from the devil, and he's not hearing from the world. I promise you, not everybody out there in the world likes us. Maybe they all like you. Not everybody in the world out there likes me. There's some people that burn my name in effigy, no doubt. But that's okay, because the Lord's not hearing from them. He's hearing from heaven. You know, the Lord put some people in charge of me. He's put his angels about me. The Bible says that when the devil was tempting the Christ, he said, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. He's given his angels charge of thee. He gave his angels charge of you. You've heard of guardian angels. I'm not preaching guardian angels. I'm just saying if there was one, they had a lot of work to do with Donnie Smith. And then the Lord's like, all right, what's going on with Smith? Are you kidding me right now? I need backup. Backup! Backup!
You better get Gabriel or Michael in here on this one. We need some help. Lord, have mercy. Clearance wouldn't have never got his wings. There you are. There you are. The first thing I said, that somebody perked up out there. Good. Clarence may not have ever got his wings if they was waiting around for Harold Harder. You know what I'm talking about. We come from the same neighborhood. We all come from the same neighborhood. He's not hearing from that neighborhood. Aren't you glad about it? He's not hearing from my past. Aren't you glad about it? He only hears from my present. He only hears about what I could be. He doesn't see what I am or what I was. He saw not what I was, the song says. He saw what I could be. He saw what I could be. Aren't you glad about that? He said, if you'll do this, humble yourself, pray, seek my face, and turn. You do that, watch what I'm going to do. I'm going to hear you. I'm going to hear you. The Lord can hear you today, church. I want you to know that it doesn't matter what your need is, okay? It doesn't matter what your situation is. And there's a lot of different situations out there, even here this morning. I'm not at all confused about it. I tell you right now that there, everybody has a situation, right? Does that make sense? But God hears you in the place of your situation. And it doesn't matter what those skeletons and those, it doesn't matter, because he doesn't hear from that. He hears from heaven. And what he's hearing is, what do you think of that, Donnie Smith? Well, I tell you what, Lord, he's a handful. He's a handful, I'll tell you that. He's kind of funny, but he loves you. I promise you, if those angels were talking to the Lord about Donnie Smith, they're going to tell the Lord, he sure loves you. Even when he's fallen down, and he's fallen down in his life, he never left the church. Never left the church, Lord. He's faithful. He's faithful. I'll give him that. He's not perfect. He's made a lot of mistakes. He's stumbled. He's tripped. He's fallen. But he's faithful, and he's here. I used to preach an old sermon, I'm dirty, but I'm here. At least I'm here. And every single one of us were born into sin. The Bible says we were shaped in iniquity, right? All have sinned, the Bible says, and come short of the glory of God. I'm no doubt, Ian, if the Lord was talking about that, what would they say about you? He's here. We like that kid. His hair's too long, but he has hair. And his Uncle Donnie is very envious of it. And maybe we can make a deal. You get it cut, I think they could save it. Glue some of it right up here. Get some gel. Get that faux hawk working or something. What's the Lord going to say about it, Evan? The Lord's going to say, you know, he made a bad choice this one time. And it lingered for a while. He made a bad decision. It's called a mullet. But he repented of it. He humbled himself. He prayed, and he sought my face, and he turned from his wicked ways of mulletum. What I'm saying, church, listen, he's going to hear you, but he's not just going to hear you. He's going to forgive you. He's going to forgive you. All right? And that's what the Lord's telling you. If you'll do this, I'll do that. Okay, if you do this, then I'm going to do this. I'm going to forgive your sin, your trespass. Don't worry about the devil. In Zechariah 3, don't worry about that guy. He's going to accuse you. That's what he does. He's the accuser of the brethren. Don't worry about that, because the angel of the Lord stood and said, the Lord rebuke you. The Lord rebuke you. The Lord will never stand against you in the presence of your enemy. The Lord will never stand against you. If you'll do this, I'll do this. I'll forgive your trespass and sin. I'll forgive your mistake. I'm telling you right now, I love that this is my temple. But you need to know that I know. You need to know that I know. At some point in time, you're going to need this recipe to get back to me. At some point in time, you're going to need this. And if you do this, if you'll humble and pray and seek and turn. If you'll do that, then I'm going to hear. And I'm going to forgive. But when the Lord says forgive, he doesn't just mean forgive it. He takes it further and he says, I'm going to heal. What he said was, I'm going to restore you. I'm not just going to forgive you, prodigal son. I'm going to restore you to sundom. I'm going to kill the fatted calf for you. I'm going to put a ring on your finger. I'm going to put a sunly robe on you. You're not, no. I know you came to me and said, I'll just be one of your servants. No, you won't. You'll never be my servant. You're my son. I'm not just going to hear you. I'm not going to just forgive you. I'm going to restore you. If you will, then I will. That's what he's saying. And so what I say to all of us here today, if I will, he will. If I will, he will. And that really only leaves us with one question, I think. And it's a simple question. Two words. Will you? We can answer that as a body. But we're going to have to answer it at some point as an individual. We found a convenient season in our life to get away from his presence. And we went after wicked. That's what we did. So what we're going to have to do now is own that. Okay, you got to own it. It's not somebody else's fault. Okay, it's not. How many times have I preached the message about the man who fell in the pit? Most know the analogy. He's walking through the woods. It's at night. He's by himself. He falls down in a pit and he can't get himself out. It's too steep. He's there. He's screaming for help. No help's coming. Finally, after a couple, two or three days, he hears some rustling around up there, and he calls up, and someone says something to him. You know, are you okay? I'm okay, but I need help. You help me get out. Next thing you know, the guy up top jumps down. Oh my gosh, what are you doing? Now we're both stuck here. And he said, whoa, it's okay. It's okay. I've been in this pit before, he says. I know the way out. Church, I've been in this pit before. Okay, I know the way out. Listen to Pastor today. Humble yourself. You got to own it. Okay, because it's not your neighbor's fault. It's not your parents' fault. No, it's not. No, it's not your upbringing. Sorry, it doesn't work like that. I know what rough circumstances look like. But you know what? I don't have a corner on the market of that. No one gets through childhood unscathed, do they? Everybody's faced something. You don't have a corner on the market of hardship. We can't make excuses. And that's what he's saying. You got to humble yourself. Get rid of that ego. If you do that and you pray, submit yourself to me. Pray. Seek me. But wait. None of this works if you don't turn. And if I'm over here at wicked and I turn from it, I got to turn back to him. But if I do it, what did he say would happen? I'll hear you. He can hear you right now. And not only will I hear you, I'll forgive you. That's my commitment. You did your part. You do your part. And I promise I'll do mine. You make, and he's, and I can see him. Can you see him? Day after day, he's looking down the lane. No, I know. I thought it was him. It's not him. It's not him. Another day goes by and he's not there. But every day there's Father and he's looking down the lane. If you'll humble yourself, pray and seek me, turn from that, I'll hear you. It's him. It's him. And the celebration already begins with Dad. Dad's out of his mind. And as he's making a one step towards him, I envision Dad, I'm not doing it, I envision Dad jumping down and running down that lane to get to his boy. I'll forgive you, he said. And I'll do much more than that. I'll restore you. And he's on pins and needles waiting to do it. He's waiting to restore you back to where you once were. John wrote about it in the revelation of Jesus Christ. I have somewhat against you, he said. Because you left your first love. But let's go back. Let's do those first works. Let's go back. Let's turn from there. Let's go back. Come back to me. And if you do, if you will, I will. And so I say to you today, if I will, he will. And I have to ask the question, will you? Will you humble yourself? Will you pray and seek him? Will you turn from those things that are distracting us from him? If you will, he will.
Alleluia.
Just right where you are. Let's lift our hands.
Alleluia, for the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia, Alleluia, for the Lord God Almighty.
Caution you about something. The Lord just told me, I want to caution you about something, because here's what will happen. You're feeling his presence. You're feeling his presence. And pride will get in the way right now. See, because pride says, I don't want anyone to know what's been going on in my life. And if I go down there and I start repenting and crying, they're going to know something. They're going to know I'm not right. That's why he says you have to humble yourself. You can't worry about that. You got to humble yourself. That's what has to happen. Pray, seek, and turn. And then he's going to come running. You watch what happens. He's going to come running into your life in a way that you can't imagine. Are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy, holy. Are you Lord God Almighty?
Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy.
You will, he will.
Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy. Holy. Are you Lord God Almighty?
Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Just you and the Lord.
Worthy is the Lamb.